Hello. Oh, is there anybody out there? I can't really see you, but I'm really happy to be here with all of you. I'm having a great time at this conference, and I hope you do have too. I want to start taking you back in time, because I think it's valuable from time to time to take an honest look back, not to bash on the past or to get nostalgic, but to put things into perspective and to avoid repeating history. So if you take a look at this highly accurate timeline of the history of NEOS, you can tell that we're quite old. It starts with the very first release of Typo3, the predecessor of NEOS, in the late 90s. That's 20 years ago, or like 300 JavaScript years. And it goes on to the first alpha release of NEOS in 2012 and the split from the Typo3 project afterwards until the rebranding 3 years ago until today. And as Robert already said in the keynote, 2006 marks the birth of NEOS with the idea to, or the decision to reinvent our CMS on a green field with latest technology. Back then it was still codenamed Phoenix, and this is not an official logo. So that was 2005, and just a couple of years before that, Eric Evans released his famous blue book and coined the term domain-driven design. And it was clear to us from the beginning that this is something we want to adopt as one of those new methodologies to follow. So in the very first presentations about Phoenix, Robert had a slide like this one. I don't know if you recognize this. This is the Tower of Babel. It's that biblical story about that tower that should be as tall so that humans could reach heaven. And then God prevented that by introducing languages so people couldn't communicate anymore. And to be honest, I don't really remember the punchline from Robert's talk back then, but it was clear that a language would play an important role in NEOS, and for that reason, you won't find any code like this in the whole NEOS core today. And this is actually a code snippet from WordPress at the same time. And let's burn it before you try to understand it. Not WordPress, of course, it's just a snippet, and they got much better in the meantime. All right, so the domain-driven design, so much have changed in flow and NEOS in all those years, and we have rewritten, it feels like we have rewritten the core like three times and changed a lot of our perception. But domain-driven design still is a very important topic today, and it still keeps me excited. And it's still kind of an abstract thing, though. And with my non-technical friends or family members ask me what this DDD thing is all about that I keep talking about, I really always found it really difficult to put it into words. But I remember when I heard about it first and from Robert back then, I had recently learned about test-driven development, so I thought, well, this is just one of these DD things, like behavior-driven, feature-driven, you know, all these DD methodologies, so I bought that blue book, and we learned all about those building blocks, you know, like aggregates, repositories, entities, and we created base classes for those and said, hey, we're doing DDD, but, well, we didn't really. So from today's standpoint, I would say those building blocks are overemphasized. They are useful tools, but the power of domain-driven design doesn't lie in the tools or in the code, but it's all about the process. And that's one of the reasons why it's so difficult to find good examples out there. Because if you look at a project that was driven by domain-driven design, it's either very complex or boring, but in any case, if you look at the end result, that doesn't contain all the discussions or decisions that have taken place to reach that final outcome. And the mention design is all about those discussions. And it's a bit like you would teleport yourself to the top of a mountain. You wouldn't have the same learning and experience that you have if you climbed it yourself. And at some point, I came across this quote from Von Vernon that I really like. And according to him, the essence of domain-driven design is modeling a ubiquitous language in a bounded context. Well, that doesn't really help me to explain it to my parents, but I think it's a very good guidance, and it contains a lot of condensed information. So the word modeling highlights that it's a continuous process. So we keep evolving the model as long as the project lives. Then it's all about that ubiquitous language, the language of the domain. So we use the same terms when we communicate with each other, when we communicate with the domain experts, and we even use the same terms in the code to prevent misunderstandings. And then the last part, that bounded context, is something we neglected in the first days, and we were not the only ones. It's covered far back in the book, and Eric Evans himself admits that he should have put it much more prominently because it's such an important concept. So let's get into that. Sorry. So it's pretty obvious that a language won't work without a shared context. The thing is, humans are very good in inferring the context from the conversation, and we're even so good that we can switch the context without even realizing it. And this is an important skill for our communication, but it can lead to misunderstandings, especially when you talk to machines, because they need all the context. So that's something we should be aware of, even if it comes so natural to us, to be aware of that context and make it explicit, and then give it boundaries. Because without the boundaries, you can start with a relatively easy thought model, and then you add concepts and features, and all of a sudden you end up with this big ball of mud. And no one is able to grasp it anymore, and no one dares to touch it. So my first takeaway for you, if you start a new project, create a context map. Context mapping is the process of splitting up one domain model into multiple domain models. And that might sound pretty trivial, but it's not so easy in times. Let's take an example. I used that example before, but let's imagine you want to create a conference management application. So you start with a glossary of all the concepts, and you use the terms of that ubiquitous language. So you might have rooms and sessions and attendees. And then the complicated part, try to split it up into the bounded context. We are familiar with splitting up software architecture into the different technical layers, like front-end data access layer and so on. But in this case, we want to split it up into the logical parts. So for example, it could split up that thing into 5 smaller applications, and then you could create separate packages for those, or even separate, completely separate projects with a different database, depending on the size of your teams and how far you'd want to take it. But finding those boundaries is very critical, and in some cases, it's absolutely not as obvious as here, but it's a tremendous help in reducing the cognitive load, and it gives you the freedom to replace different parts, because now you decouple the core functionality, and now you can even reuse existing solutions for other parts. And that is not only useful for like business applications, but it can be also useful for an EOS website. When it just grows too big, try to split it up into multiple logical parts. So to recap what we're trying to achieve here, we're trying to come up with the best domain model to solve the business requirements, and one that can react to changed requirements quickly. But I got another quote for you. And this is actually quite old. And I remember that when I stumbled upon it, I couldn't really accept it. I thought,
all models are wrong, but software is pure, and if you only work hard enough, we can come up with a perfect model that solves all the scenarios. But if you think about it, it makes a lot of sense. A domain model is, per definition, an abstraction, so you have to leave out things to make it manageable. But this initial reflex to find the perfect Swiss Army knife solution is something that I observe a lot, and it seems like DDD awakes this perfectionist in us. And striving for perfections is not a bad thing, of course, but it can be counterproductive in times. And for example, we're very good in pattern matching, so we like to categorize things and then we put them into boxes and then we create a library for it, so everything is nice and shiny. But if we haven't explored the problem domain, it's likely that that this leads to premature abstraction. And I really like that meme, but it's actually a real problem, and it has caused a lot of pain. Because with an abstraction, you always have to adhere to a common denominator, so you can only use what the abstraction provides, or you only need a subset, but then you buy into a lot of accidental complexity. So can you think of an example of that in the NEOS world? I can actually think of quite a couple, but one of my favorite ones is the party package. It's, for those who don't know, it's just a small package that provides base classes for a like person-related domain model. And it seemed like a good idea back then because, you know, every project has something to do with people. So we made it really flexible, and then you have a separate object for person names that has 6 properties, and then you can attach multiple accounts to it. But what if you only need a person and you don't want to deal with accounts? Well, it was very cumbersome to work with, and fortunately we got rid of the dependency from Flow in the meantime. But it caused more pain than it actually helped, I think, and especially with Flow, it's so easy to create your custom domain model classes. That didn't really help. And another good example is the node types package that is now officially deprecated, but it's just similar issues. So how do you prevent this premature abstraction? And Matthias Veres uses this small controlled experiments. Well, yesterday he told me he now calls it uncontrolled experiments. Just changing your habits, try to take a different perspective and explore the domain. He uses it mostly to change organizational patterns and just do something differently. And then sometimes you just get a completely new insights for the domain. And on a software level, it can mean that you use much more composition instead of inheritance, or in general, adhere to that functional kind of thinking. And even if you're not into that whole functional programming thing, maybe just as a little exercise, when you create your next PHP project, try to avoid the extends keyword and see where it leads you. Just give it a try. sometimes it's magic what it can help to think. Get away from this OOP kind of thing we learned back then. Everything is inheritance, into more like you can compose functionality using blocks. So another thing that I observe a lot is bike shedding, and I only recently stumbled upon that term. I really like it. It's that metaphorical story of a committee that should approve plans for a nuclear power plant. So they have to decide about those multi-million-dollar worth decisions, and no one dares to question the plans about the construction because they don't think they are qualified. So it gets approved very quickly, but then they spend hours and hours discussing about the material and colors of the bike shed before the building has even started. And that's something I observed doing myself quite a lot. For instance, when I come across a complex pull request and I'm not into the topic, but I really want to provide some help, so I look into it and then I find some typos and add those nitpick comments. Or this presentation is a good example where I can spend hours searching the internet for nice nuclear power plant images before I even have the rough outline of the talk ready. But bike shedding is not about procrastination, it's more about having the wrong focus or focusing on the rather, well, rather unimportant things, maybe. One example from Flow. As you know, we claim that Flow is an opinionated framework, so that means if you follow some rules, we will try to get out of your way, provide you with a destruction-free workflow so you can concentrate on the problem you want to solve. So you can write really simple code like this one, and I guess you all know this, that you can just use it and it just works like magic. You don't have to think about HTTP requests or responses, and this is actually possible in Flow since the beginning, and it's quite impressive. And we took that much further, and in our block example from the Quick Start tutorial it's called, we have this code snippet where now we map a complete form, so the user can fill out a form, and then that creates a blog post, and the whole creation of that blog post object is done by Flow, and so you only have those couple of lines, and you don't have to think about database queries or connection and so on. And I guess those of you who took that a bit further and applied it to like more complex scenarios than just creating blog posts came across those issues that this comes with, and because there are some bike sheds hidden here. So one of the things we did a lot is to focus on this whole property mapping thingy, so we extended it so it can cover all the use cases. You know, like creating a blog post and creating the author at the same time and things like this. And but, you know, the entity, the post, is actually the end result of some process, and hiding all that domain logic of creating such a post behind the magic of the framework that can lead to accidental complexity. Because imagine you want to add, like, let's say a spam detection or a review process to that, you have to glue it on top of that or somehow. So one of the main issues we started with, and we don't do that anymore, but I still see a lot of examples out there, just remove entities from the whole controller. The controller is just one view into your domain model, and what we have here is not the post, but we have a request or a command to create a post. And that can be a very simple data transfer object, so a simple dump object with getters and setters maybe. And then it's totally okay to use the magic to map that, but then the actual process of what it means to create a post, put that in your domain layer, because we still have that database structure kind of thinking where we focus so much on the structure of things, but actually the communication between objects and how they get from one state to the other, that's actually the important part, and that's the part where you really find the core of your domain, things that you can really discuss with your domain experts. Like, I've seen and even participated, frankly, in code that is similar like this one, but it's not a post, but it's a shop order. And then you have, you know, like before the order is created, I want to communicate with the payment provider, and then afterwards send a confirmation email. But what happens if one of those steps fail? And that's the questions you have to ask and how to react in those. Do you want to retry? Do you want the order to fail? That's the kind of conversations you want to have. So yeah, I mean, one thing that helps is use flow diagrams. You know, like think if we start with the request coming in, and what are the kind of paths that you can follow this process. And it's, I think this is one of the main issues I've seen in the last years, like, because it's a really gradual process. It sort of sneaks in, and you know, we've seen that really good presentation about clean code yesterday from Roland, and this is clean code. So, I mean, it's really obvious in this example, but the problem is not that the code is not clean. The problem is that you hide important things behind magic. All right, so to wrap up, I want to come back to the building blocks of domain-driven design. And I said that I think they are overemphasized. But there's actually one that I think that is underemphasized. Is that a word, underemphasized? Well, one that we neglected. And this is, value objects. Yeah. So in domain-driven design, you have entities. They are the objects with their identity. So, you know, a customer stays the same customer even if you change the phone number. And in contrary, you have those value objects that are defined by their attributes. So if you change a color, for instance, you get a new color. And that sounds very trivial, I guess. But so let's get into an example from the core. So this is the node class from the content repository. And the function name is maybe not the best, but it allows you to reach or to get some child node from a node instance you have. So you can pass it some relative path to some child node, and we'll return that child node. You can also pass it some, So you can also pass it some special syntax. It's a bit like directory traversal. So you can go up and down, and you could even pass it just a dot, and it would return the same node. Doesn't really make sense here. And you, of course, because it's just a string, you can pass it some invalid path, and it will throw an exception. You can just pass it anyways, anything actually. But the case that tricked us when we tried to implement that or to re-implement that behavior for the content, the event source content repository, was that you can actually also pass it an absolute path, and then you can just access any node anywhere else in the tree. And I mean, do you see the problem here? The one of the issues is I had to crawl through quite a lot of classes to find out what those cases are, because it's, you know, we use some helpers here and there, and it's completely intransparent what are the possible values, and we can only validate them like after, when it's already too late, basically. That's just one example, but we have that in all of the places. And this is another nice term I came across. It's called primitive obsession, and we really suffer from it. It's a bit like a virus. It got much better, and today we use those value types much more. And this is really something I want you to take away, even if you don't. If you're not into that whole domain-driven design thing, don't call it value object then, but call it value type, and create, instead of, you know, having those return type array or strings. What is a string anyways? I mean, a string or a boolean or even integer should never appear in the front of your API. That's not your ubiquitous language, unless you sell strings. So, do you have enough time? Yeah, maybe I can show how this could look like with value objects. So just create an object that represents what this thing should be. So a relative node path, for example. And to show you how that could look like, it's just a class. We make it final because we don't want anyone to extend that. And we create a private constructor. I mean, that's just one option. I like to create private constructors because then we can actually create multiple name constructors. And so you can add new constructors without breaking backwards compatibility. And it's much easier to use because now you can say, well, create me a relative path from an existing node, for example. And then you can add some convenience methods. So you could, you know, traverse, append, subpasses to existing paths, or traverse up, get the parent path. And then maybe you want to implement the JSON serializable interface. So you can just, if you encode this path to JSON, it's just represented as a string again. But so it's easy to communicate with other parts. Value objects. Try it. It's like a drug. They attract domain logic like magnets. It's you'll see if you play around with it, and before you maybe you come across those new concepts you have to implement, and you think, but where at which part should I add this functionality? And using value objects, it gets much clearer where to add those. So I think that's it. I expected to run out of time actually, but apparently I didn't. So I've linked all the code snippets as well on the slides. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Great, thanks.